Hello, and welcome to our first video, which is going to talk you through the Digital Information Technology course. Today we're going to be looking at Learning Aim A, Modern Technologies. We'll be focusing on communication technologies as our main topic area. It is recommended that you have a pen and paper ready, and you make key notes on any theory or topic that is covered while we go through the video. You are obviously able to pause or replay the video if they find that the speed is too quick. Today's lesson objectives, we aim to look at and describe what setting up and using ad hoc networks means. This includes the definition of what an ad hoc network is. We're looking at security issues with having open networks, such as when you go to McDonald's or you're sat on your train and you connect to the network on there. We're going to look at performance issues with an ad hoc network, and we're also going to finally look at issues that affect the network availability. When we use the word network availability, we're regarding what can affect the reliability of the network to the point of low signal all the way to having no signal. Okay, so hopefully you've had a think about the sharp starter question that was asked. You might have come up with different ideas, such as pairing via cable, where you will plug in the cable to one device and then the other so they can share a connection. You may have used an idea of using Bluetooth and pairing each device together to send a file across. So, one way that we can create a connection is using something called an ad hoc network. Now, an ad hoc network is a network that's temporary with two or more computing devices connected together. They don't require any Wi-Fi access points or routes to work. And because it's temporary, that means it's not permanent, so it won't be around forever. Unlike the network in your classroom, where you can log on and then come back next week and your network is still there, this ad hoc network is just to be used then and there while you need it. An example could be two teachers connecting their devices together to share files, such as a PowerPoint presentation, a Word report, or they might be sharing some holiday pictures to show each other where they have been over the holidays. So, what do you think could be the advantages and disadvantages of using an ad hoc network? Have a think and we'll go through them shortly. There are many advantages and disadvantages of using an ad hoc network. Some of the main ones are advantages. It's easy to set up. This means that we don't require an expert technical knowledge, which could save us some money on hiring technicians or expert staff to come and install the network for us. We don't need any specialist hardware required, such as a router. Now, if we don't need the specialist hardware, we don't have to invest our money in buying that hardware, which obviously saves us money and means that the money can be used on other items. Some of the disadvantages of using an ad hoc network, however, are they're less secure. If you have an open network, then anyone could walk past and join into your connection. If you think about your Bluetooth, for example, when you are pairing your devices together, you may have often seen that when you put onto AirDrop mode for everyone to visible, you will get random people on your list who may connect to your network. Now, this is okay if you're only sending a funny video or photo to your friend, but if you are sharing confidential files, then these unknown users on the network may actually have bad intentions or may be hackers and use this information for bad purposes. There's also no central device that has control, which can make it unmanageable. People can be competing to use the network at the same time. Another issue with ad hoc networks is the performance issues. They're normally less reliable than traditional networks. Poor signals can reduce access to the internet. If you lose your connection, especially if you're transferring a file halfway through, then it may stop and fail the connection. This can frustrate the user. Devices can also disconnect if they use Bluetooth from a too far away distance. On a mobile phone, it's roughly 10 meters, then the connection is lost. Now, this is not very far, so if you are trying to work on the move, you may find that you go to a location that loses your connection to the ad hoc network. And also, many devices sharing a connection can make it very slow. This reduction in speed can often frustrate the users. You may have noticed this in your household, where if your brother or sister connects to your network and your speed is reduced, your gaming starts to buffer or your video starts to buffer, which often causes frustration to yourself. Okay, so we're now going to look at another key term called open Wi-Fi. Now, open Wi-Fi is offered often for free in many places. You'll have seen some of these free Wi-Fi points in restaurants such as McDonald's, or at train stations, or in hotels when you've been on holiday. This means that you just connect to the network by simply submitting an email address or your name, and then you've got access to the network. You're not actually providing any information that tells them who you are or assigns you into an authorized account. You may have bad intentions and may be using access to the network to see what else other people are doing while they're on the network. If you don't need a password to connect to the Wi-Fi, then it doesn't use encryption and therefore it's very insecure. We're going to look at encryption on the next slide, but if you're not encrypting your work or your passwords or your files, then if people gain access to those files, they can use them without actually having to decipher them, which means that they can lead to many errors. We'll look at this in a few moments. Okay, so in regards to encryption, we consider this as a security issue with an open Wi-Fi. Having an open Wi-Fi means that all data from your device to the access point is sent in plain text. Now, this means that a hacker can view all your sensitive data, such as your password, and if they can access your password, they can then use your password. In the section I've now highlighted, I've created a simple password in plain text. So I've used password 123. Now, by clicking the encrypt button, I've now got an encrypted text version of the password above. This password would clearly be a lot harder for an unauthorized user to work and understand what it means. If the data is kept in plain text, so password 123, they can use that password to log into my bank account, they could log into my Facebook account, and they could transfer money or post statuses or steal my photos for my identity theft. However, with the encrypted text, they will not be able to use that to guess what my password would be, so therefore my accounts are now secure. Many people will have experience of using personal hotspots as a simple way to connect devices. You may have turned your personal hotspot on your smartphones to allow your tablets or laptops to make a connection. This would, for example, allow you to share your data plan from your mobile phone onto your laptop or tablet so you can connect to the internet on those devices. Connecting to a hotspot is often known as tethering. Now, we've got a question. Why is it important to make sure that a strong password is set up on the portable access point? If you don't use a strong password on your personal access point, then clearly you could have unknown users accessing your hotspot and therefore accessing the network and the data that is sent around it. PANs, or personal area networks, are networks that can connect computers or devices together using Bluetooth or Wi-Fi. For instance, a phone could connect to an in-car entertainment system to play music and make hands-free phone calls. Another example of a personal area network is the recent use of smartwatches. For example, your Apple Watch connects to your iPhone. This allows data to be transferred, such as messages that you receive, or it sends your heart rate from your smartwatch to your smartphone to allow you to monitor your heart rate and performance when exercising. It is personal to you and no one else can access the network at any point while this data is being transferred. These networks have a range of a few meters, so again, they are personal only to yourself, and devices need to be paired for security. Now, when we say pairing, this actually means it's a process used in a computer network that helps set up an initial link between computing devices to allow communication between them. So, we're now going to look at infrastructure. Now, the first place to start is the definition. This is the physical and organizational structures and facilities, such as the buildings or the roads or the power supplies, that are needed for an operation of a society or enterprise. Now, when we come to connections and allowing transfer of data, there's many different methods that we can use. We can use cables, we could have our mobile data, or we could use satellite connections. You may have been familiar with the different types of cables that we can use. In the past, we used copper cables. However, more recently, we're using fiber optics in your home broadband. Now, this offers a difference in transmission speeds, but clearly you have to pay a higher price for the fiber cable connection rather than the copper. Now, when might satellite connections be only possibility? If, for example, we're having two branches that are having to communicate, and one is in the UK and one is Australia, we wouldn't really want to put a cable from one building to the other, as it would not be sensible to run that cable all the way across the globe. So we might use satellites to send the data from the UK to Australia. As just mentioned, there's different internet connections that we can use from copper to fiber optics. Just as a little bit of information, if you had a 10 gigabyte file and you wanted to download it using a copper connection of roughly 40 megabits per second, then that would take roughly 36 minutes. However, Virgin Media offer the fastest fiber optic available up to March 2020 of 516 megabits per second. Now, this 10 gigabyte file would be downloaded in 3 minutes. So what we've done by using fiber optics rather than copper, we've taken our transfer speed and increased it to a point where we can download from 36 minutes down to 3 minutes. This is a massive reduction. If you're a business and you're having fiber that can download a file in 33 minutes less, then your employees can be working more efficiently with the time that you employ them. This brings us on to mobile data. Now, there'll be many times that you've looked at your smartphones and realized that you've not got a Wi-Fi signal because you're outside of your house network, and you can see the little 3G or 4G symbol. Now, this mobile data allows you to access the network using your data plan that you are supplied with. Obviously, if you go from 3G to 4G and in the future up to 5G, this will increase the speed that you have that connection at. Many rural homes and businesses only have the option of connecting to a mobile network for internet access. For example, if you're a business operating in the Lake District where there's no fiber or copper cable available, you have to use your mobile data to run your business online. Okay, this brings us on to a little case study now for a music festival. So, there's a large music festival that sees over 100,000 people attend. The mobile networks are normally set up to cope with just a few hundred people in these areas of the countryside. So what is the result of many people trying to connect to the same network at the same time? And how can the networks try to prevent this being a problem? Have a couple seconds to think and we'll go through the answers shortly. Okay, so if we have 100,000 people trying to connect to a small network that only supports a few hundred people usually, then we may find that this increased usage will make your network reduce in speed. You may see that you have a connection, however, when you come to make calls or send messages, they may fail to connect or to send. How can we prevent this being a problem? Well, there's a lot of phone companies that now bring in more base stations. So there's more signal points and access points for the phones to connect to because of the increased users. And when the festival is over, the phone companies can take those base stations back away because there's a less demand at that time. This brings us on to something called black spots. Now, the country is divided into areas called cells, which each have a mobile phone transmitter. If there's no transmitter present, then there'll be no signal, and this is called a black spot. You may have black spots in your house or your school. Obviously, you'll have never taken your smartphone out in your lessons in CG1, but you may have noticed, if you have, that you may have a little signal to no signal often. Also, when you go on train journeys, when you go through the countryside, you may notice that you lose your mobile connection for a period of time, because when you have black spots, you have no connection. Now, hills and buildings can also block signals and create black spots. Black spots can be a massive issue for businesses or people who live in certain areas. If you're traveling through, you may get your connection back in a few minutes' time, which will not cause you much stress. But if you live in that location of a black spot, then that means you get no signal at any point, and that will make you struggle with daily online activities. In our final part of theory for this presentation, we're going to look at rural versus city locations. Now, city locations normally have faster internet than rural ones. If we consider London against the Peak District, we need to consider that London has millions of users, and therefore the businesses are going to have that high demand for an internet connection that's fast and reliable. This means that service providers such as BT, Sky and Virgin will invest a lot of money to provide a strong service to people in this area, because they will obviously subscribe, which will lead to large profits for the companies. If, however, you're in the Peak District, in that rural location, where there's only one or two households per every couple of miles, the organisations, the service providers, will not want to set up the internet connections because there'll be no profit for them to make. Okay, so if we look now outside of the United Kingdom and we look at developing countries, there are still many countries that are yet to get a good level of internet connection. If you look at Africa, for example, in 2017, only 32% of people had access to a good internet connection. Now in Africa, there's roughly 1.3 billion people, compared to only 70 million people in the UK. However, the UK have a 92% access to good levels of internet connection. This means that there's a significant number of people in Africa that can't view news online, they can't apply for courses to become more qualified and lead to better jobs, they can't compare products online to find the cheapest prices, which puts them at a massive disadvantage. Now, we need to consider what the reasons could be that countries like Africa have low levels of internet connection. Now, this leads us to the infrastructure that we just talked about previously. They may not have good roads or cabling connections, or the cables may be copper and not fibre optic. They may not have power stations to be able to generate the power to support the systems. We're going to look at a few more points on the next slide. So as we've mentioned, a couple of the reasons for low usage in Africa and other countries could be down to the infrastructure that's in place. Because they've not invested in the roads, the cables and the power sources, they can't operate and run systems to allow their citizens that internet connection.